Hello everyone! Just before to start this new episode of the Medical Device Made Easy podcast, I just wanted to ask you a small favor. Can you please go to one of your preferred platforms like iTunes, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, just to provide me a review if you like what I'm doing on this podcast. It's really important for me because it helps me to rank and also to be discovered by more people. And also, if you want to get notified for any new episodes that are coming, so please don't forget to subscribe on those platforms, also on the YouTube channel, because yeah, then you can get all the information directly. So thank you very much, and I hope you'll enjoy this episode. Welcome, EasyMed Nation. So Munir El Azouzi speaking here from the Medical Device Made Easy podcast. And today, I want to bring you more on the side of the digital, so software. We had a previous episode with Eric Volbrecht where we talked about a specific aspect of the software for medical devices related to the MDR 2017-745. And I wanted to bring here an expert to help us to really understand about this new aspect. So this is mainly about Rule 11 of the MDR 2017-745. And for that, I have invited Cyril Michaud from MD 101 or MD 101 in French, because he's French. And yeah, so he will try to help us. So hello, Cyril, how are you?
Hello, Monier, fine. And you?
I'm very, very fine. So thank you for accepting this episode, this invitation. Cyril, as usual, I'm always asking my guests just to introduce themselves or introduce their company, if I can say, and then we can move forward in the interview. So it's your space.
So my name is Cyril Michaud. I'm working as a software medical device consultant for MD101 Consulting. So it's a company, our motto is consulting for medtech firms, in fact. MD101 is a consulting company for medtech. Okay, we do medtech, only medtech, medical devices. We don't do biotech or pharma, and we help companies getting their certification, CE certificate, or for example, or FDA clearances for their medical devices, and we help them in all the subjects related to mainly implantable devices, electromedical devices, as well as software for me. So myself, I'm at the very beginning, I'm a software developer, you know. Okay. I went up guys who are able to talk to this machine, to these strange machines. Okay, so this was the very beginning of my career, and then I switched to project management, things like this, and then to regulatory affairs in a medical imaging company. And at what time I decided to switch to the consulting side, okay, and become a consultant.
Is it the dark side or is it the white side?
So. This is you who says that. I'm working 100% of my time helping medical device manufacturers clearing their software, their medical devices for most of the time for the CE mark, okay, for the European market, but also for the FDA clearances.
Great. So, where are you located exactly?
So MD101 is located in France, and where our offices are located in the south of France near Marseille, on the Mediterranean coast.
Right.
And we have, but we have our clients are everywhere in France, as well as in French-speaking countries like Belgium and Switzerland. But we also have clients, for example, elsewhere in Europe, like Scandinavia, for example. And we also have some clients in North America. Okay, for people who would like to certify their devices in Europe, for example, to place their market, their devices on the European market.
Right. So I have a special question for you, because as you are in France, and but you are not located in Paris, because each time I talk to people that are outside of France, they are saying to me, are you in Paris? I say, no, France is big. So I wanted to ask you, if somebody wants to come to visit France outside of Paris, what do you think they should go for, or what do you think they should visit?
There are so many places in France which are worth it. You know, you could go on the Atlantic coast in the western side of the country, like Bordeaux.
You have a good wine area.
Yes, for example, or La Rochelle, the Ré Island, Île de Ré, for example, is a very nice place. The climate is mild, it's cool. It's a very fine place to go. And then, if you prefer some other place like the south of France, of course you can go to Provence, for example. Yes, where you are going to have all these beautiful places that you have in Provence, and the blue of the sky, the blue of the sea, the green of the forest, for example.
Lots green, of colors. Green when it's spring, but I think in summer it's more like yellow or.
Oh, the pine woods are still green, you know, and you know. But you have also not so well known places like Auvergne, which is in the center of France, where you have volcanoes. You know,
yeah.
People don't know it, but we have volcanoes in France. They are dormant, okay, and they are not active, okay. But we have volcanoes. So it's a very nice place too.
So you can go and visit them and see what it looks like without any danger. So great. Mm-hmm. Good. So Cyril, let's move on to the meat, if I can say, of the episode, and help people to really understand this Rule 11 of the medical device regulation. So I wanted to ask you, what is really this Rule 11, and what is the difference we have now with the medical device directive? So let's start right by that.
In fact, the Rule 11 in the new medical device regulation is a new rule introduced in this new regulation. It wasn't present in the medical device directive. So it's a special rules dedicated to software, in fact. Because if you come back to the directive, which was written in the 90s, you know, in the 1990s, software was not so prominent in medical devices. So the directive doesn't cope with the subject. You know, the software is not well treated by the directive, especially in the rules. And with the directive, in many cases, we can say most cases, you fall in what I call the default rule, the fallback rule, the rule 12, okay, which says every other active medical device is in class 1.
Okay.
Everything outside the rules of the directive are fall into rule 12. Okay, and that's why with the current directive we have so many software in class 1. Okay.
So it's easy for manufacturers. It's a self-certification for manufacturers. So they don't have any difficulty, if I can say, for putting those products on the market.
Yes, and when you fall in rule 12 in class 1, you are in good shape because you're in self-certification, where the amount of work, the overhead, the regulatory overhead is quite manageable, easily manageable. Okay. So, and due to this, okay, the problems of the regarding software from the directive, a new rule, Rule 11, was introduced in the new regulation. And this rule, in fact, if I can say it in very few words, okay. If you have software as an aid for diagnosis or for treatment,
okay.
You are in class 2A.
Okay.
If your software is for diagnosis or treatment, you are in class 2A.
Mm-hmm.
But what is the definition of a software medical device? If you come back to the definition of a medical device in the article number 2 of the regulation, mm-hmm. you will see that a medical device is a device, article, blah, 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 software, for which the intended use is the diagnosis or the treatment.
Yeah.
Okay, so if your software is for diagnosis or treatment, it is a medical device.
Yeah.
Okay? And then automatically, you will be in class 2A.
Okay.
Because the rule 11 says software as an aid for diagnosis or treatment is in class 2A.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm doing some shortcuts, you know.
No, it's good. It's
really great. The idea is there. Okay. So if you have software, it is a medical device, you are in class 2A.
So it's easy.
Yes, it's an easy way to define the classification. It won't be an easy way. I mean, nothing, but it's not funny at all for the manufacturers. It won't be an easy way to CE mark their devices.
We have still in Rule 11, I think the two or three classes. We have 2A, 2B, and 3, I think. But yes. There is some kind of different levels, if I can say, of if it brings just death, if it's damaging your health, or if it's, I mean, they bring some levels, but even this level is not really clear, if I can say.
No. In fact, it's what we call a risk-based approach.
Yeah,
okay,
exactly.
Taking the words from the FDA, for example, or things like this, because you are in class 2A when you are in low risk. Mm-hmm. You are in class 2B when you are in medium to high risk with severe injuries, for example. And you are in class 3 if your software, a software failure, could result in the death of the patient.
Exactly. Okay.
So you have two things. First, this risk-based approach, okay? And second, the regulation, the new regulation, introduces the possibility to have software, and especially standalone software, classified in class 3, which is not the case with the current directive. With the directive, the top level classification is in class 2B.
So do you have an example of a software, standalone software, maybe that can be class 3 or something that we can imagine?
Yes, so imagine you have someone having a stroke.
Okay.
A stroke. So there is a clot in their brains, okay, and they get an MRI, okay, in emergency, and the MRI is post-processed by a standalone software.
Okay.
So the standalone software processed a DCOM image file. So this is absolutely a standalone software, mm-hmm. no contact with the patient, mm-hmm. no dedicated hardware, okay, it can run on a standard PC. Okay. And the result given by this standalone software, the post-processing of the medical images, is you can treat the patient by this way or this other way.
Okay.
I don't dig into the details.
Yeah.
Okay. And depending if you have a software failure giving the wrong result to the neuroradiologist, it could lead to the death of the patient.
Okay. So this is really the risk is really high in terms of the software. The mm-hmm. software is providing you some guidance, but if it provides the wrong one, then we have the death of the patient. So class 3. So it's mm-hmm. It's really a really good, I think, good example.
Yes. So if the software gives a result, and this result, this data given by the software, is the main information used for the decision of treatment by the neuroradiologist, then we are in class 3.
Okay. So actually, we have those software that are existing or that are really working. So they are in the hospital, so they are working with the machines. But for now, those software are class 1, if I understood well.
So this one is already in class 2A because we have some manual on borderline classification, you know, things like this. So it's already in class 2A. Okay. But medical imaging is a peculiar case, and medical imaging systems are already in class 2A.
Okay. So, and by 26th of May 2020, it will be class 3. So they have to change a lot of things, if I can say.
Yes. They will jump to class 3. Yes.
And so I think we understood well now the kind of the levels. We go from class 1 to now class 2A to B3 in terms of risks. What does this change for the manufacturers? I think, yeah, this changes the fact that class 1 is self-certified, so there is no need of a notified body. Now we go to some classes where we need a notified body. So what are exactly the thinking now and for the manufacturers?
So the consequence for the manufacturers is to get a CE certificate by a notified body. Okay, so in this case you have to pass audits with the notified bodies, an audit for your quality management system and an audit for your medical device technical file. Okay, and if you want to pass this audit successfully, then you have to implement a quality management system, and you have to build a CMARC technical file with strong evidence of regulatory compliance. Okay, which is not the case in class one because almost nobody is going to review your technical file. Yeah. So the consequence is a big amount of work, of overhead for the manufacturers. The first overhead is on the quality management system. In class one, it was acceptable with the directive to have only a few procedures on post-market surveillance, okay, on material evidence, on vigilance events, medical device reporting, things like this. So it was very reduced. Okay, the technical file was sometimes not very enough, I would say, not enough to or not at the level expected by the notified bodies.
Okay, if
I could rephrase. And when you are in class 2A or above, so you need a quality management system first. So then you are prone to put in place an ISO 13485 quality management system first. So it means a lot of procedures, about 20 procedures. Okay, so you come from procedures and you go to 20 procedures.
Yeah.
First, and the proofs needed, the evidences, the documentation needed in your technical file will be thoroughly reviewed by the notified body. So it means that you have to put a lot of work on the content of your technical file to bring evidence of compliance to the general requirements, the requirements of the regulation. Thus, as a consequence, you have to implement standards, okay? Standards related to software, to risk management, to usability.
So I imagine, for example, for a company that is not on this business or is on this business but was not need for them to implement those rules. For example, some standards that are really medical device related were not used before. I think about the 62304 that was not used for creating their documentation or their DHF. And now they are selling products on the market, but they have to update, if I can say, their level from zero quality system, as you mentioned, or something existing but not really certified ISO 13485 to something that is certified. How are they doing with the previous? I mean, how are they doing to make this transition if the product is already on the market? So what is exactly the problem that they have now? Because they don't have maybe all the documents needed.
Mm-hmm. In fact, so all companies working with consulting firms already have Technical Five in place because, you know, we know the regulation, we know the requirements. So when we implement a Class One Technical Five, we already fully implement the requirements. Okay. The main drawback of being in self certification is that you don't know to what extent your technical file is compliant to the regulations, to the regulatory requirements. Whereas building a Class One technical file, we don't put so much effort or pressure on the manufacturer. Whereas when we are in Class 2A, we know the expectations of the notified body, so we put a lot of pressure on the manufacturer to be compliant with the regulatory requirements. If I could say that, and it means that, especially in Class 2A, you have, so I mentioned the software development standards, the risk management, the usability, and the fourth one is the clinical evaluation.
Yeah.
Okay. The demonstration of safety and performance and the balance of the risk benefit balance. Okay. And all of this has to be thoroughly demonstrated and documented in a Class 2A or above technical file. It means that sometimes for Class 1 medical devices, we use the possibility of validating the clinical aspects of the device through literature, okay, and only literature, which is going to be less possible in Class 2A, and less possible in Class 2B, and impossible in Class 3.
Exactly. Okay.
So it means that, especially for the clinical aspects, okay, the clinical evidence, the demonstration of safety and performance, and the risk-benefit balance, we have to put in the technical file a very fine-tuned clinical evaluation plan and clinical evaluation report.
But so as you mentioned, so we have Class 3 also, where now we need clinical studies, if I can say so. What are we doing in case we have nothing? So should we start now a clinical study, or what is the idea?
So in fact, you have to, I think that in any case, okay, that's to prepare the transition to the new regulation, that's a good idea to put in place an observational study of the use of your device to acquire clinical data. Okay.
It's like the PMCF.
Like a PMCF. Like, okay. Exactly. So it's a bit more than a PMS, okay, a post-market surveillance.
Yeah.
It's a PMCF is acquiring clinical data from the field, like maintaining a register of patients that you pick at random, things like this. Okay. So an observational study. To acquire data from the field to be able to have clinical data for your future submission with the medical device regulation. Okay, because most everybody now has their device on the market.
Yeah.
Okay, in one class, so they have to transition to another class with the regulation. Okay, the regulation requires clinical data. Okay, so the way to collect clinical data is to put in place to implement a post-market clinical follow-up, with your current device. And then from the transition from the directive to regulation, you will use equivalence, okay? Yeah. In the demonstration of clinical evidence with the regulation, okay? You will demonstrate that you are equivalent to an existing device, which is your device with the directive regime, okay? And to demonstrate this equivalence, you use clinical data, the clinical data coming from your PMCA.
Good. I think it's a good tip for those companies that are now looking for a strategy on how to do that. So they have really, I don't know if there is a lot of companies that are maybe not aware of what is happening with the Rule 11, or if they didn't really start to think about what they should do. So instead of investing on a clinical study, just having a PMCF can be also a strategy if you can gather enough data so that you can show equivalence and move them to the new medical device regulation with your device. I think it's a cheaper solution than to start a really big clinical study for that. We talked
an additional remark. Usually, it's easier to obtain the green light from the local authorities to perform an observational study than performing a clinical study with the patient in this one.
Yeah, because you have to also evaluate benefit risk or evaluate all the effort that you have to put in place on this, I think.
Especially the risk when you have an investigational study.
Yeah, exactly. When we discussed first about this topic, you talked to me about something that I was not really aware, but I think it's really interesting maybe to bring that here. It's about the difference in terms of this rule or the regulation for standalone and embedded software. So is there something that we can maybe bring to people to see if there is a difference here, or if it's the same, or how we should consider them both? So maybe just also to explain what is the difference first.
Okay, so standalone software is running on hardware for the general public, like software running on a PC, software running on this kind of things. You know, every software which can run on a off-the-shelf hardware, okay, that you can buy in your preferred shop, okay, for example. And that's the first thing. You have the embedded software. So it's a software embedded in a dedicated hardware designed by the manufacturer. Okay, so like an ECG, for example, is a medical device with a dedicated PCB, electronic card, okay, and this PCB has software inside, a firmware, okay, and this is embedded software. Okay, so to answer to your question about the Rule 11, in fact, the way the Rule 11 is phrased, the wording of the Rule 11 is applicable to both standalone software and embedded software. Okay, because nowhere in Rule 11 you have the word embedded or standalone. So it means that the Rule 11 is applicable for all software.
So is it then also a risk for some products that are already on the market because maybe they are classified 2A now and they can be 2B later just because they have an embedded software?
Yeah, I think that's so every cases are in nature, so that's possible. Okay, but I think that most of medical devices having embedded software won't change of class like this, I think.
No. Okay,
but that's a possibility.
You have to look at case by case study for that.
Yes, on a case basis.
So, we have also something that we talked also with Eric Volbrecht is about a corrigendum that is planned to be issued. So, do you have some news or some information about that?
Yes. A colleague of mine has posted a LinkedIn post on the corrigendum is available on the European Commission website. Okay, it was published in March the 13th. Okay, and prior to when we prepared the podcast, we discussed about that. But I have sad news for you: the corrigendum doesn't have any good news inside it for the manufacturer in currently in class one.
Okay? Yeah, I lost also because I have just reshared one of the blog posts of Eric Volbrecht, who said mainly the corrigendum is not what you were waiting for.
That means that
we had no real change or no big change, if I can say, in terms of this corrigendum. But yeah, when this episode will be published, it will be nearly 2 weeks or 3 weeks from the publication of Eric's. But I really encourage you to go and read also Eric Volbrecht's blog, where he's talking about also the corrigendum, if you want to hear more about that.
Yes.
Okay, great, Cyril. So is there something else you want to add on Rule 11, or we really made a great explanation to the people here?
Oh, yes, I think we had a quick tour of the Rule 11. So far, I think you have the most important information on it. Okay, so the change of class for software and the need to implement a PMCF on your existing devices.
Good. What, maybe my question is maybe more for you now, because as you've said, you are more working on this area, mainly on software. So are you dedicated to software, or are you, what is, in terms of work now, or actually, what is the proportion of work on software and work on classic devices, if I can say?
You mean because you mentioned class C device, class 3 device, you mean?
No. What is the proportion? What I was mentioning is mainly the proportion of you as a company of MD 101 working on software and working on classic devices.
Okay, classic. Okay, sorry. So we have at MMD 101, we have as of today 4 people working on software and mostly software only devices. So we have a pool of experts working on electromedical devices and software, because software is also in electromedical devices. But yes, we have 4 people working on software, and we have a pressure of the market on software, especially if we talk about artificial intelligence, things like this. Mm. And most of all these people spend most of their time right now on standalone software and electromedical devices.
So it means, is it with the new companies that are starting to work on that, or is it all, existing companies that are developing this area? So what is it exactly?
Yes, most of our clients on the software, standalone software field, are new companies, startups. Okay. And yes, we have very few of them are existing companies launching new products, standalone software.
Okay, so there is really a market that is starting to grow, I think, in terms of software. So this rule will impact more and more people. So I think they will need some support. So what are you offering exactly to companies in terms of helping them for software development or solving issues, or what is exactly your service for that?
So in fact, we help the manufacturers of standalone software or software as a whole, or medical devices, on the CE mark. So we can help them on the topics I mentioned. So the software development, managing the software development to be in line with the requirements of the standards, managing their usability studies, managing their helping them doing the right way their risk assessment regarding software, which is a peculiar in terms of risk assessment. We also have people more specialized in clinical studies, helping the manufacturers in their clinical validation.
Good. So I think you have a complete portfolio for companies if they want really to work with you. And I think you have enough experience, if I can say. You had enough customers where they had problems to solve, so you had enough experience to help them. Just one question. I see behind you something called Rendezvous Expert MedTech. So do you want to talk about that a bit more? What's that?
Yes, so that's an event we organize every year in France. So we have three sessions this year, one session in Paris, one session in Lyon, and one session in Lille. So the sessions in Paris and Lyon happened at the beginning of this year. The next session will be in Lyon during the MedFit event. Okay. The MedFit event is going to take place in Lille. Okay. And we will be present there. Okay, and we have also plans to export the Rendezvous Expert MedTech to other countries, but that's still a secret.
So we'll hear maybe about that on another episode or later on LinkedIn. So great. So do you have something else for people?
Have fun, even if the times are a bit harsh time or interesting time.
Yeah.
Yes, have fun. Especially for people developing software, don't forget to keep the interest in software development. You know, this is where I come from, and I know how fun it can be to develop software.
Great. So good. So where can people follow you, or where can people can see you? So I will put that in the show notes. But Where are you most famous, or people can really check with you?
So you have two places on the web. So you have our website, md101.io.
Okay.
So this is our main website. And you have also my blog. So it's blog.cm-dm.com, where I post articles.
I think you write also in English, because I saw some of your articles. So it's also in English.
Yes, everything is in English. So we have an English version of md101.io, and my blog posts are also everything is in English. Okay, if you want to be present on the web, English is a condition. Yes.
Exactly. Great. So anyway, I will put all those information on the show notes. So great. Okay, so thank you very much, Cyril. It was really a great talk, and I hope people were really following, maybe taking notes, I hope. And just wanted to ask people, so don't forget to subscribe to the podcast. Don't forget also to provide a review. It will be really helping me a lot. I thank all the people that already started to make a review. This is something that is taking really few minutes for you, but with the iTunes, with Google Podcasts, with all those platforms, it provides really a lot of support, because then we go on the ranking and we can also show up to more people. As I said, the objective is really to help you to put a compliant medical device on the market, and that's why I invite some guests like Cyril. So I really thank you for that. So Cyril, thank you very much. Thank you for your support, and I say to you goodbye and have a good day.
Thank you, Monir, for your time. It was a really interesting, a great podcast to be with you today, and see you soon, I hope.
Thank you. Have a good day. Bye.